I had really, at your age, no idea what my life was going to hold. From school, I went to university and did biochemistry and molecular biology. I contemplated medical school, but I considered it was going to be too hard, so I decided it wasn't the job for me. So from university, then again, I came to this drifting, I have no idea what I want to do. So I did a PhD, because that put me off having to get a job for another 3 years. And I was really lucky at this stage in my life. I went to the University of Cambridge in the UK. I'm sure you've all heard of Cambridge. It's a beautiful city, and it really has been the cornerstone for my career, because I've come out with a degree from a really good university. So it's worth at your stage working hard to get to university if that's what you want to do, because it really will help down the track. Still now, people say to me, you did your PhD in Cambridge, wow, that's really impressive. So I thought long and hard and decided, get the hell out of England. I worked doing a postdoc position in Massachusetts for 3 years. And then I met this English man in America who had a lab in Adelaide, and he said, why don't you come and work for me? So I packed up everything I owned in a couple of boxes and shipped it out to Australia. I'd been here once before on holiday for 3 weeks. I'd never lived here. I knew nobody in Adelaide. I came for a job that lasted 2 years, and I've stayed here ever since. I think that's a sign of what Adelaide life is like. And I've done two positions in Adelaide, and now I'm a research fellow. I'm actually funded by a leukemia fellowship, which is from Marjorie Jackson Nelson. I'm sure many of you have heard of Marjorie. She used to be the governor of South Australia. Her husband died of leukemia in 1977, and at that stage, she started raising money for people with leukemia to try and get research to help them stop getting sick from the disease, find some cures. And she likes to fund researchers who are passionate about this topic and who can really make a difference. And I like to think I fit that bill. I've been to Puerto Rico, I've been to many countries in Europe, I've been all over the States and Canada, all of these places are to conferences. Now you may add on a couple of days, a week, to travel and look around, but it gives you the opportunity to travel around the world, which is something that I would never have thought of as one of the perks of being a scientist. And when you go to these places, you meet people whose work you've read, whose ideas you've thought of, and you think, wow, you know, these are like, sounds really sad, but these are your heroes, your scientific heroes. And you get to meet them at conferences, and you talk to them, you have dinner with them, and it inspires you to keep on with your work. And my topic, the day in the life of a scientist, all I can say is there is no such thing as a typical day in my career. And that is really probably the best part about my job. This is something to really consider. You will not have a typical day. But pretty much I tried to give you an outline of what an average day could be. I'm an early starter. I'm a morning person. I'm up at 5 o'clock. That's my choice. That's not all scientists. A lot of people roll in bleary-eyed at 10:30. I spring in getting off my bike at 7:30, but that's my choice. First thing I'll do is check my emails, because science is such a variable job with people all over the world corresponding with us. I have emails coming in all during the night, going through student projects with them, helping them decide what they're going to do next, helping them interpret what they did last, helping them think about where they're going with their project, and trying to see the bigger picture of what's going on in the lab. Apart from that, really, I don't do a whole lot of lab work these days. We are trying to develop drugs and therapies for people with cancer. But what makes our research different? Invariably, they are given a drug or a therapy. Now, this therapy will kill the cancer. It will also kill some of the cells that don't want to be killed, but that is a feature of cells in the body. These cancer therapies, in general, are non-specific. They are just poisons that will kill all of the cells in your body. The cancer goes away quite often, but within a few years comes back. Our job is to try and develop something to give after chemotherapy to stop the cancer coming back. And we're doing this for people with leukemia. Leukemia is like a liquid cancer in your blood. It's not a solid tumor like breast cancer or prostate cancer that can be chopped off and gone away. Leukemia circulates around your body. It affects all of the organs. The blood in your body comes from a process called hematopoiesis. Now, hematopoiesis is a very active process. It starts in the bone marrow, where the stem cell lives. And the stem cell we call the mother of all cells. The stem cell will generate all the cells in your blood. Your blood is needed for your immune system. If you lack red blood cells, you're anemic. You become very tired and listless. You can't have any energy. You can't run around. You can't keep going. If you lack white blood cells, you become very prone to infection. You start getting every cold that goes past, you get every infection that goes past. If you lack platelets, you bruise very easily. And this is very difficult for management. If you cut your skin, your blood flows very quickly and won't stop bleeding. All of these things happen when you have leukemia. You lack red blood cells, white blood cells, and platelets. And it's all because the leukemic cells take over your body and hematopoiesis doesn't work properly. Now, chemotherapy acts on any cell that's growing really fast, which is why it's so effective in cancer. But it also kills the fast-growing cells in your body. What it doesn't kill is a cell I mentioned previously, the stem cell, what we call the mother cell. This cell has gone back to sleep in your bone marrow because it's done its job. It's made all the cancer cells. So it generates all these cells and then just goes back into what we call quiescence or a very deep sleep. Once the cancer's gone away from the chemotherapy, the stem cell wakes up again and starts to divide, generates a lot more cells, and the cancer comes back. So our job is to try and develop therapies to kill these stem cells because we want to make sure that cancer doesn't come back after people have had chemotherapy. And we liken it to weeding a garden because all of you will know when your dad or mum has sent you out to weed the garden and you go out there and you just pull all the weeds out, leave the roots behind, the weeds will just grow back. They are not going to go away. And cancer therapies are very similar to that. If you give chemotherapy, it's just like snapping all the roots off and snapping all the weeds off and leaving the roots behind, those roots being the stem cells. If we can come in now with our weed killer, our drugs, our therapies and kill the stem cells, then hopefully the weeds or the cancer won't come back and the patients won't get relapse and they won't get their cancer back again. So I had to think really long and hard about this. This is my last slide. This is the pros and cons of being a scientist. Now, the pro, it's a great job. It's fun. Hopefully you can understand from what I've said today, no 2 days are the same. You don't go into work thinking, oh, today I'm going to put things in alphabetical order all day, or today I'm going to answer the phone all day. You go into work thinking, I wonder what I'm doing this morning, I wonder what's going to happen this afternoon, I wonder if I'll get out in time to watch the block tonight. All of those things. So this is my list of what I think the perks of my job is. As I say, it's fun. It's interesting because you're doing things that you can relate to. Everybody knows somebody who's had cancer. Everybody knows how awful the suffering is. Now, of course, all research isn't cancer-based, but I'm talking about this from my perspective. It's very flexible. If I have an appointment and I can arrange my work around it, I can leave the lab, go to my appointment and come back later. Because although we're paid for a work week, we think about work all the time. As I've said before, it's unpredictable. I don't know some mornings what's going to happen the day I have a list of things I'm going to do, but I never get them done because all these things arise. Students come in, they want to have chats, they want to go through stuff. Experiments haven't worked, we have to reinterpret our data, but you do get to experience a lot of things that I probably wouldn't have done without this job. So hopefully today I've taught you a little bit about what it's like having my job, and if any of you have any questions, please feel free to stick your hand up and ask. I won't be biting your heads off on. I won't think any question is a stupid question. So thanks for listening.
Hayley, I thought it might be interesting to perhaps talk about some of the challenges that confront you as a researcher.
Biggest challenge is probably money, getting money to sustain our research. We are funded by Federal National Health and Medical Research Council. They fund at the moment between 12 and 15% of all grants. And it's a harsh reality, but it is probably the most difficult thing. The other difficulties are things like day-to-day management of what you have to do. You have to prioritize, your mind has to be clear. You have to see the bigger picture of science. You can tend to become so focused on what you're doing, you forget about putting it in context and you forget about what the big story is, what the question you're trying to answer is on a bit more scientific level.
And perhaps one last question or thing to leave students with today is if there was one piece of advice you would give students as they're approaching a Year 12 research project, what would that be?
Go for what you want to do. Don't listen to your mum, don't listen to your dad. At your stage in your life, you know what you want out of it and you don't need to be told. But do put in what you want to get out. Because if you work hard, you'll get far more out of it than if you just go with the attitude, I don't want to be here, I don't want to do this. They won't want you there either. So just make a bit of an effort and you'll find people will respond to that and respect you a lot more. So thanks for listening.